This episode of NSFW, we have Korey and Martin from Spill.com. We'll discuss this year's best movies and we'll confess our secret movie shames. Coming up on this episode of NSFW, right now.
Netcasts you love.
From people you trust.
This is Twit.
Bandwidth for NSFW is brought to you by CacheFly at CacheFly.com.
This is NSFW, episode 5 for December 22nd, 2009, Hotel Rwanda for Dogs. This episode of NSFW is brought to you by the new voice-activated Sync, featuring hands-free calling, music and podcast search, and turn-by-turn navigation, available exclusively on Ford, Lincoln, and Mercury vehicles. For more details, visit SyncMyRidePodcast.com. And we are live now. It is NSFW, the new sauce for the Webernets. I'm your host, Brian Brushwood. I put the BB into the BB, into the NSFW. I almost said
that. How much you had to drink, man?
I started off with it a little bit then. With the NSFW, the new sauce for the Webernets, joined by my co-host, Mr. Justin Robert Young. How are you doing, Justin Robert Young?
I've never been better. I'm flying on cloud nine right here.
I gotta tell you. No, we can't because we're having some issues with the playback stuff on here. By the way,
Cats never closes.
And here's my co-host who just stepped into the other room. What's that, Justin?
Well, you see, what's weird is everyone at home, they're hearing it just fine. It's only us in the studio who can't barely hear him at all. By the way, I'm joined in studio by my good friends. It is Korey Coleman and Martin Thomas. Hey, is it common knowledge that your name's Martin and not Leon? Do you have people call you Leon in real life?
Yeah.
Leon is this cartoon character. Like, so yes, they call you Martin or they call you Leon?
They call me Leon.
They call you Leon? And you're cool with that?
Yeah, I prefer it, actually.
You actually prefer Leon over your name thing? Awesome. All right.
Why don't you just go by Leon?
Yeah, why don't you have your name legally changed to Leon?
Because
that's
once I said it as legal, then I can't get out of it. But right now, I have two personalities I can jump into back and forth.
Very well. No, I see what you're doing.
Stupid game. Yeah.
All right, look.
Hey, man, the hoes guess.
That goddamn Leon's an asshole.
Martin Thomas,
pretty cool.
He's a hell of a guy. No, yeah, that makes total sense. By the way, so let's do this. Before we get started, let me announce we are going to do our contest. We are going to select right now the best movie of the 09. And you could thank Justin Robert Young for that fabulous visual. By the way, for those of you listening us to the on the audio feed, you really need to be live. It's a different experience live because you can see us and you can see what the hell we're talking about. Every Tuesday at 10 p.m. at nsfwshow.com. nsfwshow.com. Tell us a bit, how are we going to pick our best movie of the 09, Justin?
Well, first and foremost, we have to have some horses in the race here, Brian. So we're all going to go a little round table. And first things first, before we get this episode kicked off, we're going to each nominate one of the movies from 2009 to be in the running.
Fair enough. And I tell you what, if you're watching us live, head on over to nsfwshow.com and then you'll see the poll that we're about to put up here live. First, we have to take nominations because, let me tell you, your votes matter in this regard. This is a voice of the people operation. We want to represent the real people, the geeks out there, when we go forward.
We would like to represent. I ain't never heard you be so white before. Oh, God. We want to represent the people.
Look, my fellow Americans. All right. So let's do this.
Here we go. President Guy Whitey Corngood.
All right. So let's do this. I'll give you the first nomination then. Korey Coleman, what is your nomination? Your first nomination?
Precious.
Best movie, Precious. 09. Okay. Yes. I have not seen Precious.
Precious. Oh, you would, racist.
What? Who, me?
Yeah. Sure. I bet you you're out watching all sorts of white people movies.
Yeah. Oh, I see. Oh, thank you. That's
Brian, you know, you were all over the Blind Side.
Yeah.
Where the white people help out the black kids.
Where they have black pet black people, but you know, but a movie about a fat black illiterate woman, you don't want to appreciate, you know? What kind of deal is that?
Not if she can't play the O-line. Listen, if she can't open up that seam for the running back.
By the way, for those of you who had the over-under, it was less than 5 minutes till the race card was dropped. Like, literally.
And I didn't have to drop it, you know?
An allegation of racism.
Wasn't us.
Well, that's good. All right, so yours is Precious. Number two, let's go with Martin. What do you say, Martin?
I'm going to say The Messenger.
The Messenger. Wow. These are two movies that I have not seen. The Messenger.
You should see that movie, people, if you haven't seen it.
I'm going to go with District 9. It was the biggest surprise of the year for
me. That's the only movie I saw this year.
That's true. Yeah, and I tell you what, man, it's a blessing and a curse. You guys see a lot of crap, but you actually get to see, you get to be there to discover the next gem the moment it comes out. That's got to be an amazing feeling.
This was a real good year for movies. I mean, it's not a good year for Oscar movies, because that's a big toss-up. It's like, as far as like best movies, like, man, there's so many that were good, but I don't know what stood out. But just overall,
it really was an odd year to go to 10 possible best picture nominees, right?
Yeah, this year going to 10.
And I'll tell you
wide
what, open. What was cool about this year, up until we got into probably this month and a month before, I was thinking this might be the year where science fiction might actually top my list. Because I was thinking, you mentioned District 9. I thought District 9 was going to be up there.
Yeah.
I really like Star Trek. I didn't think Star Trek would be like in my even top five, but it was going to be on my list. And I thought, like, all right, this is the year where with 10 nominations for the Academy Awards, they might be forced to nominate something like District 9.
Right.
And then some other things came in.
Everybody's saying that Avatar is already on track with a bunch of nominations.
I like District 9 better than Avatar, and I like Avatar a lot, but District 9 is a much better movie to me.
Yeah.
Sherlock Holmes is a much better movie.
See, I was just going to say, like, when it comes to like the best movie, I'm saying The Messenger because I really like this movie. I want people to go see it. But it's like a toss up between The Messenger, Star Trek, Sherlock Holmes. I just watched that a second time and loved it.
Wow, Sherlock Holmes is really that good?
Yeah.
Love Sherlock Holmes.
Yeah. I mean, I was thinking about it yesterday. I was like, man, Sherlock Holmes is the Batman movie I always wanted to see before Christopher Nolan made the two that he
Batman
did.
Begins. Yeah.
Yeah.
Man, that's awesome.
By the way, you know what I like? And people who are just watching this or listening to it on the audio podcast aren't going to pick up on this. But whenever I talk and Brian still leaves the camera on the two guests, you guys just look around the room as if, like, where is this guy?
Talking about Star Trek, it's the damn Enterprise in here. That's why I ain't never seen so many monitors in my life. I don't even look.
Even your guru would walk away from this like, what am I supposed to do here?
I'm in here about to have a seizure looking at all this.
And actually, you can see, like, we got the glowing red lights and everything. We call it the Cylon Base Star. Did you guys ever watch Battlestar Galactica?
That's kind of lame.
What?
I haven't.
That's racist.
But now that I have an HDTV, I'm going to get it on Blu-ray and watch it.
I'll be honest with you. That was, like, always one of those shows where, like, I hate it when somebody said, like, hey, you watch Battlestar Galactica? And I go, like, no. And I'd be like, what?
But you only saw one episode.
No. Our friend Colin bought me the box set of the first season. He's like, here, you never saw this show? You watch this. And I watched that, and I was like, man.
Oh, you can't. How can you say that?
I'm serious, dude. It just didn't do it for me.
All right.
Before we go any further, let me register my nomination. I think I've seen it, I think, a few times in the chat room, and I don't think it's going to be a surprise for anybody, but mainly because of Don Cheadle, I want to throw Hotel for Dogs in there. So here we go. Hotel for Dogs, number one for me.
Are you serious? Are you really?
No, it was number three on my list. I mean, I gotta say,
and we were talking a little bit about, you know, having a different kind of movie, go ahead and get up in there. But you have a lot of the classic elements of movie making. You have a hotel.
Now, are we talking about best movie of the year? Are we talking about best movie of the year that features dogs staying in
hotels?
Because that's where it fits in my category.
I didn't see it, but was it like Hotel Rwanda, but just made with dogs instead?
It was a shot-for-shot remake of Hotel Rwanda with dogs. The choreography was phenomenal.
Oddly enough, Nick Nolte shows up and gives the exact same speech he gave in Hotel Rwanda, which I don't know if it really fit in Hotel for Dogs.
All right. So our lists are, we're going to move forward here, but we got the poll has been created. We've got Precious, The Messenger, District 9, Hotel for Dogs.
He's fucking around. Don't you put that on there. No, I don't even allow you to do that. You take that off.
No, dude, that's his pick.
That is not his pick.
I don't get to tell him what his pick is.
Did you guys see Don Cheadle's performance in Hotel for Dogs? If you haven't, then I don't want to hear it.
All right, first of all, hold on. I can scuttle the poll and we can do it all over again. Is that really your pick?
Yes, it's my pick.
Bullshit.
This hotel was made for dogs, Brian.
Movie pick, and I'm here having to deal with this kind of nonsense.
Listen, I don't know. How dare you, sir? How dare you impugn the authority of Justin Robert Young?
You're making a
mistake. Credit to Robot Parade from the chat room, who pointed out that it wasn't as good as Hostel for Dogs.
Hostel for Dogs.
Eli Roth.
Michael Vick.
Okay. Okay, so let's do this.
I'm the messenger for dogs. The dogs go to tell them that their families and family members have died.
Yeah,
but the families will get sad because, like, oh, you're so cute. Tell them my son again.
I hate that. Cancer.
Michael Vick adopted you.
No.
Right. I was sorry, bro.
Right. No. Okay. Real quick, it occurs to me that some of the folks at home may not actually be aware of what spill.com is. And you guys have, I guess we'll talk about our history later on. But for those of you who don't know, spill.com is hands down the best movie review community site out there. You guys every week put out two or three very tightly edited, very well produced animated short movies, essentially, where you review, like, I mean, the reviews is the vehicle by which you guys operate, but really it's a comedy show. I mean,
it is. That's what I try to tell people. People try to say that it is a movie review site or it is an entertainment news site, and I'm like, no, it's actually an entertainment site, not entertainment news. It's there just there to really entertain you. I'm not into trying to tell people how to spend their money for movies. If they do that, then fine, but really I just want people to laugh and every now and then see a side of us that they normally wouldn't see.
Right, and keep in mind also, like, and somebody in the chat room asked, better than Rotten Tomatoes? And I would say, yes, absolutely. All you get from Rotten Tomatoes is what the consensus is on vanilla. Like, highest rated movie ever on Rotten Tomatoes, Finding Nemo. You look at Fight Club, 66% positive reviews. Anything that polarizes people that it's not useful to me. I would look at that and I'd be like, oh. Well,
Finding Nemo is a great movie.
It is a great movie, but freaking Fight Club.
I do love Fight. And again, to be fair to Rotten Tomatoes, I mean, really, when people try to compare us to other movie review sites or the movie sites, I can safely say this without feeling like I'm bragging. We are doing something differently than what everybody else has done. And by that, I mean, like, well, we have the animation on there, but we also... I'm not out trying to, and I don't think anybody else is trying to convince anybody, like, you should go see this movie. It really is just a bunch of guys who get together and talk about films. And sometimes during our podcast, just talk about anything.
Right. Well, and I tell you, that's another thing I like is that you guys, even the review system that you guys use is very down to earth. It's the way people would actually use, because you express it as you have Better Than Sex, Full Price, Matinee, Rental, or some old bull.
We have added that. And also Better Than Sex. You know what? I mean, our tagline is, if it's crap, we'll tell you. So if nothing else, we're like, look, we saw this. If you listen to us, we're trying to save you some money.
Right.
Or tell you, like, look, you got only $20. This is where you should spend it.
But see, this is where him and I differ, because I don't think I should be telling anybody how to spend their money.
No, you shouldn't, because your opinions are terrible.
Oh, please. Hey, man. Please. Oh, I like this comedy.
This is the entertainment.
I like the way he sprung this routine on me. He's like, hey, this is like comedy right here. I didn't rehearse this with you.
You didn't rehearse? It's all improv.
I'm improv this. I have always felt like I have no right to tell people what to go see. I always feel like people have different opinions.
All you can do is express your opinion.
Because
you can
talk about I'm joking with a man up here who I think that's crazy to say hotels for dogs are great. But you know what? If he really believes that and he enjoys the movie that much, who am I to tell him, like, oh, that movie was bullshit. You shouldn't like that movie. I'm like, if he liked it that much, that's his personal entertainment.
I agree with you, except Hotel for Dogs. Come on. Hey, that's bull.
As the father of a 6-year-old, I have watched Hotel for Dogs a lot. And so, you know,
but not by choice.
Well, I'm just going to say that there are
finer
nuances.
And isn't Don Cheadle's performance magical and transcendent? Say no to that. I dare you. A double dog Hotel for Dogs dare you.
All right, well, let's do this. Let's take a look at which one you want to do. You want to do Avatar or Paranormal Activity? Which
Paranormal
one
Activity.
Okay, we're going to watch a little bit of their review and get an idea for what they do.
Everybody, let me reenact this movie for you. If it was with black people, opening credits, Paranormal Activity. We called in credits. That's it.
That's funny. That's funny because usually when black people move into a white neighborhood, white people end up leaving. Like
racist. Goddamn robot.
But they did say that whatever it was that was haunting this house, it was following the girl who supposedly was haunted.
Okay, one douchebag in a suede coat said that. Yeah, I would not have suede. I'd be like, well, you know what, brother? I'm going to take my chances.
Obviously, it takes a little while for it to build up each time. I'd be like, you know what? This is pretty bad right now. I'm going to go somewhere. That motherfucker's going to have to take a bus to find me. It's going to need a map. It's going to have to search the internet.
Hey, look. Because the moment some spooky start happening in the house, the first thing white people do, they put on that Sherlock Holmes hat, they put on that magnifying glass, and they start trying to figure out clues and what's going on. It's just like, and when it's obvious, like, the door's opening by itself, the Ouija board is moving by itself, and they still like, what the is going on?
And on top of that, these days, now they want to videotape it, turn it into a TV show. Yeah.
What? Well, which is what this is. Have you ever seen that show Ghost Hunters? This is like a big episode of Ghost Hunters, really.
Yeah, I don't watch that show because it's bull.
Yeah, well, it is bull.
And leading into this movie.
Okay, so what this movie is about, people, is like, if you remember the Brer Witch, the Brer Rabbit.
The Brer Witch.
If you remember the
whatever Blair, you do, Satan, don't throw me in that briar patch over there.
I was born in the briar patch. This movie is reminiscent very much of the Blair Witch Project. It's shot on video. It's shot with unknown actors. And it deals with some supernatural force, which has you screaming for an hour and a half. What's going on out there? What's happening?
No. It's an hour and a half of the guy going, what the f***? What the f***?
I know you're there. What the f*** happening, man? I will give them this. This is not someplace out in the woods. It's not secluded. It's not a house that's like on the hill away from everything. This is a very populated suburban neighborhood.
All of a sudden, everyone's getting all somber.
The names are Katie and Micah. Yes. Mika decides to go ahead and start videotaping this. Unlike Katie, he's not scared. He's like fascinated by this. He's almost taking this as a joke. And while they are asleep at night, they start to see some strange behavior. Things move by themselves. There's footstep sounds on the stairway.
Actually, I'm going to step forward here because we only got.
It will probably even work
better. Because I'm tired of you talking.
I'll be watching it by myself, and when it's done, I'll be thinking of scary. But watching it with a crowd, I was laughing the whole time, so I'm going to give this a rental. But I absolutely do recommend this to people who are very afraid of ghost stories.
I mean, it's walking that balance beam for these films the whole way, just perfectly balanced, and then it sticks its landing. Because, goddamn, if the last 30 seconds of this film isn't a total, like, we couldn't think of what the fuck we were going to do, so here's something really stupid. It almost ruins the movie. It's still full price for me.
No, if that guy had half a fucking brain, he would wake up, notice his girlfriend just standing there, and what I would have done is I would have grabbed her and put her up against the door just so she'd keep that f***ing door shut.
Well, yeah, yeah. So, or alternately, finally a chance to f*** her in the ass. I knew you'd agree with me.
Yeah, she ain't waking up. I can kind of do it, everything I want to do to her.
Exactly.
That chick, she would have woke up with a sore ass, whipped cream, and honey all over and all kind of food. Even that ghost would have looked at me doing it to her and would have been like, you know what? You were far more scary than I am. Yeah.
No, that ghost would have called the police and had you guys arrested.
Oh, 911. I know you're not going to believe this, but I'm Satan and I saw some f***ed up shit.
Oh, man. That's the way the format for Spill, and I love that you guys keep it short. You know, each episode is about like what, between 4
even
and
though
seconds.
You sped through it.
Not short enough, apparently.
I'm gonna just fast forward through this because I like the way you tried to cover that show because you know we only have a certain amount of time. You know what? But you bored.
The funny thing is, Ryan, he didn't even finish his statement. I'm trying to fast forward through this because you know. And it's like,
he trailed off.
Yeah,
I don't gotta just fast forward this because I'm kind of, you know. Because what, Brad?
Because I'm a little bit bored now. By the way, in the chat room, I got to ask you guys about this because maybe I'm the only one who feels this way. But in the chat room, they were talking about The Hangover. And maybe I'm the only one who feels this way, but it's like I was actually really disappointed watching The Hangover because I felt
there
like
that, the best. No. Let me finish.
Oh yeah. Okay.
The
because
best joke was given away in the trailer.
Not the best joke. I would say all of the jokes save one. The only surprise the entire movie long was a naked Chinaman dude popping up. Naked Asian.
That was in the commercials.
Oh no. Yeah. No, that was the best part, actually.
I would say to you that it, to me, it was the funniest movie I saw this year.
But had you seen any trailers beforehand?
Yes.
Yeah.
You had?
Yeah.
As a matter of fact, they played the trailers at some other movies.
Like,
and when everybody, when all my friends were going like, oh, that's so awesome. I can't wait to see it. I was one being skeptical, like, going like, yeah, probably all of the funny stuff is in that trailer. And I found the movie absolutely hilarious. Now, I also have the perspective of I've had 3, maybe 4 experiences like that.
Okay. You know what's funny?
So I totally identify with everything that was going on.
I did not, but let me say this. I think people who... When did you see the movie? Let me ask you that.
I saw it like 3 weeks after it was out. And and it did have that problem where it had been overbuilt up.
It was overhyped. Yeah. I can tell you that right now because I saw the movie. You know, we saw the movie ahead of time. And even though we had seen a lot of trailers, we weren't in there just for the jokes. I mean, before even any of the jokes came up, we were already laughing at how those guys were getting along.
Yeah. Yeah.
I mean, there was just little small jokes between them. Like, the way everybody would react to, what's his name?
Galifianakis.
Just everybody would look at him when he would do something stupid. I mean, there was so many things in that movie that made me laugh. I'll tell you something. There were a lot of things in that movie that made me laugh besides what I saw in the trailer.
Well, but I tell you, like for example, in the chat room, and somebody else said it before I could, like, Cloudy with a Chance of Meatballs was way funnier, I thought. Like, I laughed nonstop. I don't know that
it was way funnier, but I can't say, like, I mean, a big part of comedy is the element of surprise. And Cloudy with a Chance of Meatballs was a huge surprise because I expected it to be a piece of shit.
Yeah, me too.
No, but I had watched your review. In fact, actually, literally, I watched your review and I was like, hey, Monty, what do you say we pick Bunny up from school and go straight to see this movie? I mean, it was based on the fact that you almost gave it a better than six. You said if it had just one tearjerker moment, you would have been all the way in. And I was blown away. So I had high expectations based on what you guys said, and I was laughing nonstop the entire time through. So I don't know. But
again, it's two different kind of films.
They really are.
I mean, I'm looking at that as a family film, and I'm taking the jokes as family friendly jokes. And
but
then
you
I'm
see,
looking
I'm
at,
not. But like half of those, I mean,
yeah. But isn't Cloudy with a Chance of Meatballs, you know, a much lower hurdle to climb? I mean, Hangover has to be funnier than Old School. I mean, like Todd Phillips, for whatever you think of him as a director and a writer. You know, he has, somewhat of a pedigree that he has to jump over to be like, all right, this is a good movie.
I thought it
There's
was funny.
There's no expectations on Cloudy with a Chance of Meatballs.
No, I thought it was funny than Old School. And
The Hangover?
The Hangover.
And I loved Old School. I saw Old School like four times in theater.
But I thought The Hangover was funnier than Old School. And I really like Old School. I love Old School.
And
but,
Brian, you know, you got us saying, I mean, you know, our little crew telling you like, oh, Cloudy with a Chance of Meatballs is a great surprise. Go see it. You ran out. Do it. That's fine.
Yeah.
But you had 3 weeks of The Hangover being the number one movie and everybody saying, this is the funniest thing I've ever seen.
Yeah. And I tell you, the thing I like the most, the guy who played the weird guy who was on Dog Bites Man, that was Zach
Galifianakis.
Yeah. I mean, mainly I spent the whole movie just happy for him that he finally got a movie that showcased his talents because I thought he was hilarious. I thought
you think G-Force showcased his talents?
Was he in G-Force?
Yeah. I know my man up here, Hotel for Dogs. That's second on his list of best movies this year.
G-Force is a pile of shit. Let's be honest here.
Let me tell you something about The Hangover, though.
All right.
There are some movies that you see and you think like, and even though I'll give you a little bit of honesty here because we never come out. At least Leon and I are always open about how we feel about movies. We saw Terminator Salvation,
yeah,
and really liked the movie. And I think, and this is, we didn't even talk about it. I came out and said, you know what? Maybe I rethought that movie. I saw like most of it again, and don't feel that strongly about it. And he said the same thing. Yeah. And looking at the comparison I'm drawing here between that movie and The Hangover is that I look at The Hangover. They showed me a lot of good jokes in that movie.
Right.
Now, you had a different experience than I did, so I'm only speaking for myself. But I went in there and thought, like, as funny as those jokes were in the trailer, those were some of the obvious ones. I really liked the movie because of the subtlety of it and some of the other jokes that worked better. I look at something like Terminator, and so we have a case of them showing you a lot of things, key moments, but the movie worked better for me. I look at Terminator Salvation where they showed you way too much, and that really took away from the film.
Yeah.
Terminator Salvation showed anything worth watching in the trailer.
Well,
like it was a horrendous film, I thought.
I won't say horrendous.
Is going too
horrific.
Far.
I still really would defend the movie and enjoy it, but the one thing I would say is that it missed something that James Cameron always did. And as silly as James Cameron got in some of his Terminator films, and I think Terminator 2 did get kind of silly, he never disregarded that human element in it.
Yeah.
And that is what was missing from Terminator Salvation. But the biggest thing that they did in Terminator Salvation, and if anybody hasn't seen the movie, walk away right now and come back in a minute. One, two, three. Okay, you had your chance. Terminator Salvation revealed that Sam Worthington was a cyborg. That should not have been revealed.
You realize I could not get up and leave and... Well, I'm just saying.
Dude,
it is a freedom fighter action for us to spoil that movie and have less people go see it.
Yeah, it's in the trailer. They revealed the guy with a fucking half his face gone.
I mean, it was one thing when they released the toy way in advance, it showed him as a Terminator. But then in every trailer, it was in there.
All right.
But come on, are you telling me that you wouldn't guess even if they didn't reveal it?
You know what? I don't know that I did. I think I only saw the teaser trailers with the explosion, the city, and the face, and that kind of thing.
Well, then I'm sorry.
I apologize to you, sir.
Don't you ever forgive me?
All the callers and the talkbacks are like, fuck!
I just ruined it. I
just bought it on DVD. Oh, my aunt just sent it to me on Blu-ray for Christmas. Thanks a lot.
Brian, you are a magical motherfucker. Hypnotize yourself. Say, make yourself forget that I said this.
So, chat room wants to know what you guys thought of Inglourious Basterds.
I think him and I are a couple of the people who did not like it as much as everyone else, but I still did enjoy the movie.
Because I'm telling you, this guy right here, most likely, if he wasn't busy sacrificing his integrity for some comedy, then maybe he would have put Inglourious Basterds.
I deny any opportunity to say that I'm being paid off by Disney to nominate Hotel for Dogs for our prestigious award, first and foremost. Secondly, Inglourious Basterds, I mean, I'm so in the tank for Quentin Tarantino, it's not even a joke. But I thought it was fantastic. I thought it was his best film since Pulp Fiction. And I love Jackie
That's
Brown.
What everybody says. And I agree with that. It is his best film since Pulp Fiction. I just don't think it's great.
Let me tell you, I have a personal problem with Quentin Tarantino.
He stole your soda? He drank your milkshake?
Yeah, he burned him on a Coke deal.
Yeah, exactly. Just snorted it all. I had a bag. I turned my head back around. He looked like the Joker, like, white face.
It was a bad scene. I had this dead body, and I tried to snort in this house.
Hair turned green and everything.
What do you mean, man? I'm a Joker.
No.
That's $800.
Quentin Tarantino. Now, I think Inglourious Basterds is an entertaining film. I really liked it a lot. Yeah. And whenever I say I didn't like it as much as everybody else, everybody thinks like, oh, you hated the movie. No, there's a lot of entertaining things in that movie. And that guy, Christoph Waltz, should get Best Supporting Actor. I really enjoyed
that. That's a lock. That is a mortal lock. Bet your house on the fact that he's going
to
win.
If I had to bet, yes, I would bet him. But I tell you something that I don't like about Quentin Tarantino that everybody thinks is cool and they give him a pass on. He always has to put in how much he knows about film history and music history. And I love Quentin Tarantino so much because I watched Jackie Brown, Reservoir Dogs, and Pulp Fiction over and over again.
Really? You watched Jackie Brown over and over again?
I love Jackie Brown.
Jackie Brown is a fantastic film.
There's only a few movies that I watch over and over again these days.
Maybe I'll watch it a second time.
Watch it again. I'll tell you, there's two movies I watch over and over, and it's Training Day and Jackie Brown.
Training Day was phenomenal. And again, it's because of your reviews. By the way, I mean, like, literally, you guys are my proxy. I just assume, because we so rarely disagree, or if we do disagree, I understand why we disagree on individual things. Sure. But I think you guys, far and away, have the most insightful. You speak most to people, you know, plus or minus my age, 5-10 years or so. I mean, that's an awfully big amount.
I can't speak for everybody because I know Training Day has its flaws. It has some major flaws. But as far as rewatchability for me, that's one of my top movies of the decade.
Yeah.
Now, I won't say it's right up there. But Quentin Tarantino, I know his work so well, I think, that I notice the times when he's actually doing this trick of, I know so much about movies that I gotta write it into my scripts, and I think he's a great enough director and a great
but
enough
he's
writer.
Always done that. Can you start blaming him for doing that now?
Can
when
I ask
that's
you something?
Literally been the foundation with which he's built his career?
But there's a point when a person has to evolve and move on to the other thing. I mean, the biggest problem I have with him and Robert Rodriguez even more so, is that every film is like, oh, this is an homage to some other bad filmmaking, and it's like, okay, that's kind of cute once in a while, but don't build a career on that.
Let me ask you something. Did you like Death Proof? Did you love Death Proof?
I did.
No. I thought Death Proof was it kind of indulged the worst of Tarantino in terms of dialogue and stuff like that. Rewatching it now that I'm not like waiting for it to be a fantastic Tarantino movie, I like it way better than I did seeing it in theaters. But of the Grindhouse double feature, I really, really dug Planet Terror. And I was like, on Death Proof.
I dug them both. I thought Grindhouse got a bad rap. I thought it was an amazing experience. I laughed
because they released it on Easter.
Yeah, I know. I mean, it was.
You mean like amazing, like the way Jay Leno called you amazing?
Yeah, no, that's amazing with an exclamation part. This is amazing with a period.
With three exclamation marks.
Amazing.
It's like, man, this is amazing. These guys spent $11 million to make the kind of movie that used to cost $10,000.
But that's just it. It's like they totally, like that moment in
Planet Terror. Yeah, they just wasted a ton of money.
And you know what? And a lot of people didn't buy that shit either because they knew. Why go do that when I can watch the authentic kind of Grindhouse movie knowing that shit's sincere?
But I would agree with that on Planet Terror, but I don't agree with it on Death Proof because Death Proof was such a sucker punch. He spent the whole movie following the conventions to a T, and then he ends it with that reversal.
You go, that's just saying I'm willing to be bored until he does something cool.
No, that is true.
Yeah, well, I mean, it's like a minute.
It's like you sit there for an hour.
There are a few people who write as cool of dialogue to women as Tarantino, but this was all of that in his, you know, his worst kind of self-indulgence of, hey, I'm Quentin Tarantino, I can write cool dialogue for cool chicks, and let me prove that by having a 45-minute scene of girls at a table and talking about nonsense.
Thank you, my man, and that conversation was nothing. It was, not only was it not worth anything, because I've heard a lot of people say, well, that's how girls talk. I'm like, you know, show me one
every
girl
I know,
like
every
that.
Girl I know who's seen that movie hates that and says, yeah, we don't talk like that.
Really?
At all.
Anybody who says they every talk like that, them. Show me one. And another thing is, look, and excuse me, people, I'm just going to say it. We joke around using the word nigger all the time. Whoa. But Quentin Tarantino, I mean, I came into Brian's house and I said to his wife, what's up, nigga? And your nigga baby. She was holding the baby at the time.
And the baby went.
Yeah, he said, yeah, right on. Baby gave me some dap.
Here we go. Baby gave me a pound. We've broken that taboo here.
Baby said, what's up, motherfucker? But,
Can I break out the Obama clips now? Now that you're disregarding all language
see,
content.
It's terrorism when Obama gives a pound, but when a white baby does it, it's cute. When a white baby says nigga is all right. Nah, but in that little sequence where he was doing that, he has to crowbar that word into certain bits of dialogue to show how down he is with having seen blaxploitation movies and how down he is with Samuel Jackson. I'm like, no, motherfucker, it's not cute anymore, okay? You know, wow. And no women talk like that. That dialogue in the middle of that movie meant nothing. You're going to learn, Brian, before it's over with, that Grindhouse ain't as cool as
all
you
right,
think
all right. I love it. You're giving me the Grindhouse talk like it's a drug. You're like, listen, you may think Grindhouse is cool. You may think watching this piece of trash makes you one of the gang.
You thought you bought us, though. You thought this we were guests. This is an intervention. I'm intervening.
We need to fix you, sir.
Yeah, no, Justin set this all up.
You did. I like the way Brian turned to the Wicked Witch.
We're here to fix you, sir. Actually, I slip into my brother's cackle from time to time, the Butter Brother.
He does do that.
He does do it. I love that about him. All right, let's do this, guys. Real quick, I want to take just a moment to actually thank our sponsors, the folks who make things possible here.
Roscoe's Ribs and Rice.
I know. Right. You guys can't believe we actually have a sponsor.
We're about to ruin that, though.
Yeah, no more.
You used to have a sponsor until you got you two jokers on.
Who's your sponsors, Brian?
Yeah, you know what? Let me tell you, dude. The Twit Network, they don't play around. They got some serious deal. We are actually sponsored by none other than the Ford Motor Company, specifically.
For now. You mean for now, we're sponsored. Currently, we are sponsored by the Ford Sink.
Wait, say that again, Justin. I couldn't
I
hear
said,
that.
Currently, we are sponsored by the Ford Sink.
Yeah, that's right.
Tune in next week.
For the next 20 minutes.
We still
off of Highway 6 in Tyler, Texas.
No.
The Ford dealership. Please, stop by on Saturday for the free corn dogs.
Oh, you guys are killing me. The chat room.
Look for the guy in the gorilla costume on the side of the road.
You guys are, you're all turning on me. All right, gentlemen.
With the busted transmission.
And I'm gonna turn off your microphones. I turned off your microphones so I can talk to the nice people about...
We can talk about the Ford Sink, everybody. Hello. Yeah, right. It's your friends here at NSFW, and we'd like to tell you about the Ford Sink.
Yeah, no, seriously. This episode is brought to you by the voice-activated sink. Do you guys know about the Ford Sink?
I'll turn you back up.
Do you know about the Ford Sink?
No.
You don't know about the Ford Sink?
No. You're going to
say sink. So. Yeah.
Well, isn't that a shame?
S-Y-N-Z. I'm sorry.
Yeah, the Ford Sink. Get the first car to sink without water.
Yeah. So the Ford Sink.
I'm sorry. No, it's a great car.
That's.
I was about to get one myself.
So the Ford Sync is actually, it's a system they've got that it actually, like if you got an iPod or a Nano or a Zune or whatever, you plug it in and the first thing it does is it sucks down all of your music library. So everything becomes voice activated, voice controlled. You drive along, you just click a button and you just say, you know, play whoever and it'll play whatever. You play track whatever and it'll play track whatever. It also sucks up all of the names. And then you could just say the name of anyone in your contact list. So you drive along, you're like, hey, I feel like insulting Brian's race. So you're like, call Brian Brushwood. It's like calling Brian Brushwood.
So if you tell the car to cut those Negroes down, you won't be able to listen anymore while they sit in the car with you.
That's right. That's right. And so the other thing is it has turn by turn and navigation with updated, like, to-the-minute traffic information. So it's like, if, you know, each day, even if you're doing a route that you do all the time, it actually knows the traffic and it'll tell you when to go different ways. Why
I'm laughing because he's laughing. But why? You know what? Can I say something?
All right, yes.
Really?
Yes,
I'm
please.
You know what? I'm going to be nice because, man, these people pay your bills.
They pay your bills. And for let us say that we've just, this is what we do. We just sit in here and clown because that's what happens when we get around each other. I heard about this car. I read about it. It is an amazing automobile. And I recommend anybody out there to get this thing because I've actually ridden in this before.
Have you ridden a Ford Sync vehicle?
Yeah, I have.
Yeah, you remember the time we were driving out to your lake house and we got a car smashed into us?
Yeah, yeah. You guys got in a car.
And airbags right? didn't deploy?
They didn't deploy?
No, he's kidding. No, he's kidding.
Well, they didn't, but it wasn't a Ford.
Oh, No.
I have ridden in one of these cars before. It is amazing the technology that has caught up with these automobiles today.
Well, and that's the thing is like we're talking about it. In fact, I'm actually literally thinking of going out and renting one because I feel bad talking about it when I haven't got my the wheel myself. I mean, I understand intellectually the fact that it's all voice activated. The other thing is it'll actually read your texts to you because it's like you're driving along and your phone goes bing and you're like, yeah, I really shouldn't. Oh, what the hell? By the way, you know, in Austin, they're making it illegal.
No, it is now.
I thought it was illegal as of the first of the year.
So wait, will it comment on your text?
Yeah, it
will,
should.
Will it be like, that bitch is lying. Don't listen to her.
Well, no, let me say something.
It will read the curse words. And it'll be like, you know, you missed your fucking exit. And then,
no, let me say
wait,
something.
Hold on. Wait, what abbreviation is that that it'll read?
No. It doesn't translate abbreviations. It does know to say LOL.
YF.
Like it won't. It won't. If it gets LOL, it won't say LOL. It'll say, you know, laugh out loud. It'll translate those. And you also have like a bunch of 20. You have like 20 different like you're just driving along. You just twist the knob to like, you know, sorry, honey, I'm driving. And it'll send a text out.
The wonderful thing about this car is that Ford is the first one to realize how dangerous it is to do what you do, like when you're trying to text, you're trying to talk, you're trying to like find music on your iPod.
But it also recognizes that we're not going to give it up. It's just, it's like they're smart enough to say, it's like, yeah, look, it's dangerous. And so we're going to make it as safe as possible.
Everything to be safe, they made voice activation better than ever now. So this is something that I could use. This is something I wish everybody, Ford is somebody you should follow for this kind of model now.
So basically this is like Knight Rider.
That's what I said. I said you actually talk to the car, and the car talks back to you. It's freaking kits. You're just driving along. And what I think they should do is that. What's the name of the actor that did Knight Rider?
Michael Hasselhoff.
John
Hillerman.
I was gonna say James Earl Jones.
You make a mint if you could. I'll spend $100 for a John Hasselman pack that just make me like. And he could call me Michael all he wants. He'd be like, you know, play the Strokes, and he's just like, I'm sorry, Michael, you don't have that album.
I mean, the car won't even just tell you, like, when you're driving.
I like how in your perfect scenario, you don't have the appropriate thing. Like, even in your absolute fantasy, you're a failure, Brian.
Play Coldplay. You know, no, the car, I need to tell you. Like, I was riding a car with my friend who had the car.
Yeah.
And I was on my phone, and the car even told me. I thought my friend's like, you are being fucking rude right now. I'm like, I'm not even driving, man.
I don't care.
Yeah.
All right.
So anyway, folks, the Ford Sync, available standard on all new Ford vehicles.
Yeah, my Ford Mercury and Lincoln vehicles. I'm going to drive one. I'm going to go rent one. Next time, I actually am going to pay for the upgrade next time I have a gig on the road just so I can actually get behind the wheel and play with them and sync it with my phone. One other thing. They like to know that their voice is being heard. So if everyone, if you like the show or if you hate the show, you know what? Let's try an experiment. If you want – actually, no, I don't want to try this experiment. Let's just say if you like the show, what would mean the most to us would be if you would go ahead and tweet out, you know, love the NSFW show, pound Sync My Ride podcast. Now, it used to be I think the contest is over. They were giving away free Nanos and Zunes. Maybe they are. Maybe they are. And if they are, then great.
In fact, I can personally guarantee that they are still giving away Nanos and Zunes right now. In fact, the 40th person to write it right now with NSFW on it will get a Nano or a Zune their choice. Right.
And you can take
40.
You can take that up with Justin Robert Young for sure. Somebody says, by the way, chat room has a valid complaint. He says, I hate the show. It takes up all my Tuesdays, which is it's like the best angry comment we've ever gotten.
Well, are people mad at us yet?
You know, I don't know. Chat room, are you guys mad? Are you mad at these?
He's holding his hand up.
I'm covering
up the chat room.
They ruined your show.
That's right. They came in with their lousy
It was so rude to the Ford car.
They want to know.
The car wipe your ass for you. It's a great car. I'll tell you. Car did magic tricks for Brian. Brian brought on stage. It was his opening act. Brian pulled, the car pulled a rabbit out of a fucking hat. It was crazy. It's an amazing automobile. It really is.
All right, that is the Ford Sync. And if you want to make all of us at NSFW happy, go ahead and tweet out that you dig the NSFW show with NSFW or SyncMyRedPodcast.com. We'll anything else we got to say that I missed there? Because I totally forgot.
Oh, no, no, no. Just everybody, please go do the Sync My Ride podcast right now.
.com. Yeah, yeah. Please. Sync My Ride please. Podcast and SyncMyRidePodcast.com. Head on over to that. So now here's the important question. You guys, experts at movies, right? Everything you say, I believe. I don't know if I'm an expert, but I do say so.
Why is anybody watching your show if you guys aren't experts?
Yeah.
Is that just random dudes on the street talk about stuff and get animated? You know, you guys are experts at least of a certain degree, right?
Sure.
All right, fair enough.
Yeah.
You know what? In lieu of any real experts, we will be the default experts.
You're the expert understudies.
Don't bring false modesty onto here. You have a successful site where you're talking about movies. Of course you're experts.
Okay. Nice. Sure. Right. We'll take that.
Yeah, okay.
All right.
All right. So here's the question. Are there any movies that you are weirdly defensive about? Like, screw you, I love that movie. Like, because I've got one already queued up. The moment, it was Justin's idea to talk about this. And what the moment yours? He said it. Actually, I want to hear Justin's first. Actually, I'll tell mine first. Mine is the movie Tron. Like, I get upset that people don't
know. People love Tron.
Yeah. No.
People love Tron.
That's a pussy movie.
Yeah. No.
Yes, I second the motion
Chat room.
How many of you guys have seen Tron? Seen Tron, yes, or seen Tron?
If there's 16, it doesn't count.
Yeah, see, that's just it. They're all 16.
Fuck them.
Those 16-year-olds you try to pick up when you're on the road, sure, they don't like Tron.
No, but let me tell you, it's like I've got a weak spot. Every time I watch it, and by the way, Tron is the very best movie to have on in the background. Like, so visually, you can look at be like, I don't remember Tron when I was in second grade. And then but it's the worst movie to give your full attention to. It's absolutely terrible and dated. But I'm so stoked. That, so super stoked.
That's the way you defend the movie?
Yeah, no.
Seriously, dude. You are not doing my eulogy.
Okay. No, they came out and totally ruined my show, but they're great guys. I mean, they're awesome.
I'm sorry, Brian. You knew what you was getting into.
So here's but by the way, you saw the stuff for Tron Legacy, right? The new Tron movie coming out.
It looks great.
Super excited about that. Yeah. Complete with old Jeff Lebowski on the
No, Tron Legacy is the sequel I've been waiting on for years. I know they've been rumored to do a Tron sequel, and I thought it would never happen.
Yeah.
So to see Tron Legacy come about and to have it like finally with the technology that we have now, but still keeping that old like neon look.
Yeah, no, gorgeous. They nailed it. It's gorgeous. Okay, and so I assume since this is your bit, Justin, you already have one picked out. What are you weirdly? And I want to see, for those of you who don't believe that Justin Robert Young actually has a soul. I want to really peek on the inside here for what you dig.
Well, it's funny because kind of both of the directors were brought up previous, and it really, in a lot of ways, plays to the worst of both of their kind of tendencies. But I am an absolute super mega fan of Dusk Till Dawn. I can watch Dusk Till Dawn over and over and over again. I 110%.
I completely agree with the first half of it.
Yeah, no, yeah. The first half was amazing.
People either love the first half or the second half, and it's like either they hate the Super Tarantino thing, or they love the Super Rodriguez vampire horror part in the second half. I love both. I love the fact that it takes this complete 180, that we go from the suits and smart dialogue to let me stab Tom Savini in the chest.
And like, that's literally awesome. There's a moment where they clearly are like, okay, what do we know about vampires? Like, there's this brainstorm session where they have to remind everyone that it's a vampire movie that it's randomly turned into. I mean, that's cool. I'm glad you dig it.
That's why, I don't know. And for some reason, it's like, it also is like a vector for like new friends, people I don't know all that much. We're all just be talking about movies, and somehow Dusk Till Dawn will come up. And it's like the people who really love Dusk Till Dawn, I always like for some reason just I wind up becoming better friends than people who don't.
But so
I
hate the chat room. The chat room called it Dusk Till.
Yeah, I'm sorry. I want those people who thinks neither part works that well.
Really, you didn't like the first half.
I liked it to a certain point. I liked it till they set the guy on fire and he was running around and being goofy. And I didn't like the part at all where they had the woman in the trunk. I had a bad experience at the movie theater. If you've seen the movie, they kidnap a woman.
That's the first minute.
Wait, hold on. There's a part in the movie where they kidnap a woman, they tie her in a trunk, they indicate that she's raped, and then she's brutally murdered. And people think because it's a Robert Rodriguez movie and a Quentin Tarantino movie that they should laugh at that part. And I kind of felt
nobody laughed when I saw it.
John Wayne Gacy motherfuckers like, are you hanging out with that people are chuckling over that
scene?
It was
at the screening that I went to, and I was like, and I saw with a bunch of people who were so hyped up about it being a Quentin Tarantino movie and a Robert Rodriguez movie, and they were giggling during that part. And I was like,
that's horrifying, man.
Now, I tell you, and that's the thing, is you can never divorce yourself from the situation under which you watch a movie, which is why, time and time again, I swear I will never see another movie anywhere except for the Alamo Drafthouse. And every time I violate that, we're out of town, we're like, well, I'll go see it, it's local theater. The jackass factor, it's the barrier to entry. Like just about everybody going to the Alamo Drafthouse ends up spending like $50 to go see a movie. And at that level, and they make it real clear, it's like, we mean it, dude, don't talk during the movie. And they, for some reason, it's just always great whenever I see it at the Draft House, and I hate every movie's anywhere else. You're looking at me weird. You don't agree?
No, that sounds fine.
You guys have to see movies wherever they're being shown, right?
True. Yeah.
All right.
I don't know how to elaborate on that.
What?
We actually like to go see movies. Sorry,
no, I think the Draft House is great, too.
OCD fussy.
One thing I really hate about the Draft House is like when I'm really into a movie, and the waiter is constantly getting in my face, asking you next
call.
To me.
It's like, last call.
Yeah, I'm like,
me.
Get the fuck out of here. I'm trying to watch this.
You know something? I've come to deal with that because it's such a good theater. And I know they haven't found a halfway point to like solve that yet. But I think somewhere down the line, they'll even perfect that system even more. But yeah, I appreciate the Draft House so much that I pull myself away from that because it used to distract me too.
Yeah, I just know that's going to happen on like the moment of the big reveal on Kaiser Sose or something like that, to where I'm like, what? No, I'm fine. Wait, what just happened?
But I tell you, but the difference is like that is a known quantity. I know that twice during the movie, someone's going to come up and ask me if I want anything versus some, you know, Jack. Like I go to movies and random teenagers discover the light switch in the utility closet and turn it on and laser pointers. And it's like,
the Alamo has so much going for it that is a very small complaint for me. And I've never had a moment where they've come in and ruined the movie for me. The only time I've really gotten irritated is when I was waiting for my credit card and it was given to me after the credits rolled.
Oh yeah.
And that's the only time I've been like, okay, come on now. But other than that, Alamo Draft House.
It's a great place. That's my only complaint other than that. And their nachos are really awful.
Their wings are good. Apocalypse Now.
I remember a time when they had like.
Yeah. I'll tell you what, guys. I'm really glad we're playing to a wide audience with what to get at the Alamo Draft House.
So, tell us. I did. Spill the beans. What is your secret shame? What's the movie you're randomly defensive about?
You go. Because I hate to bring mine up all the time. Matter of fact, I was on the site today saying like this is the last time I'm ever talking about this.
Okay, I guess yours is Spider-Man 3.
Yeah,
which the director himself has said he made a mistake with.
What? Yeah. You liked Spider-Man? What's funny? It's like I'm all like, guys, this is a safe place. you can bare your soul, and I'll understand. It's like Spider-Man 3. What?
I remember Leon's face when he asked me, say, "What'd you think about that movie?" I was like, "I didn't care for it too much." You're like, I knew you were going to say that. Damn, I didn't know you felt that strongly about it. I was like, thought we were going to have a conversation. I'm sorry.
All right, so for you, it's Spider-Man 3. No judgment,
now,
no shame.
Hold on. I want to know what the great parts about Spider-Man 3 are.
What
hooks you in to Spider-Man 3?
Oh,
none. I'm sorry, go ahead.
This is
I'm going to keep this conversation short because every time I bring it up on our site, it goes on for way too long.
It does.
Yeah, it does. It does. As a matter of fact, even today I was like dealing with it. And a lot of it is from the fact that I really did not like Spider-Man 2.
Spider-Man 2 is awesome.
No, it's not actually.
Safe place. Go ahead.
It's really not. And for like, so you know what? I dislike Spider-Man 2 for a lot of the same reasons I don't like A History of Violence. I mean, they have a lot of the
coherent
same
coherent plot and fantastic acting.
Yes, those are what he hates.
Huge, gigantic holes in the plot, like things that like just don't make sense. The character motivations don't make sense. And I went to Spider-Man 2 wanting to love it, and even when things were coming up that I was like, that's all right. I'm ignore that until it got to be like 15 things. And I was like, wow, I actually don't even like this movie. The only thing I liked about Spider-Man 2, watching it over and over, is the action scenes. And then in Spider-Man 3, it's packed with those. So I'm like, well, okay, completely fuck Spider-Man 2.
And finally, you get that rock solid plot arc of the Sandman who escaped from jail and.
I'm sorry. What was your movie again? Was that Dusk Till Dawn that you mentioned?
Yes, Dusk Till Dawn. You got a solid crime movie that suddenly turns into a vampire motivation. Everybody gets
with Cheech Marin yelling, "We got skinny, fat, old."
All right, gentlemen.
You know what I have to say though, dude.
If you can find the years, hotel for dogs.
I can't really get.
Yeah.
All right, gentlemen, safe place. We're all in the box. We're in the box.
Yeah, you keep saying
we're
that,
in the safe box.
That way.
No, that's all right. No, we'll see how it feels when Corey shares his secret shame.
Well, I'm not defending my movies for one thing. I like what I like, and that's it. Now, one movie I will defend. I have two movies here. One I will defend is. People make fun of me for liking Pinocchio, only because I'm a grown man who loves the movie.
You're talking about the original animated?
Pinocchio is considered like one of the best animated movies of all time.
It is. But you run into some people, a lot of people, in fact, who like say, Pinocchio, that's one of your favorite movies. And I don't know if it's because it's coming from me, but I have to say, you know something? That movie is a technical marvel. It's a major achievement.
There's no shame in liking that.
I have none.
It is constantly at the top of the list of the best animated movies of all time.
He's like, listen. I went out on a limb and I said, I'm not afraid to admit it. I like Citizen Kane.
Yeah, right. Exactly. That's what you just did.
No, because there are a lot of people. You think that a lot of people would like that, but a lot of people.
You're talking about people in the hood back in Waco when you grew up.
No. See, Pinocchio has been overshadowed throughout the years, even by something like Snow White. So a lot of people who even aren't into animation will say, well, yeah, that's the first full-length animated motion picture. Okay, that's cool. But then you'll get some people who will say, what, Pinocchio? I think we've all been in that situation
where you're at a party, you really like Pinocchio, some random dude likes Snow White, you pull knives, you know.
Him and I are fighting, cops are called, we're in the yard fighting and shit.
Yeah.
And people are like, what are they fighting about? Well, he like Pinocchio, he likes Snow White. I don't know what the fuck I got to this point. How did it escalate? I don't know.
All of a sudden, Corey's got his shirt off. He's just like, Pinocchio!
I got no strings!
Oh my God.
No, hold me down, bitch!
A month later, he's getting shot out on the streets of Las Vegas in front of a casino. And nobody knows what happened.
Yeah. No, that's the movie that I found myself having to defend myself.
Okay, you said you had two picks. What's your other one? Well, since you decided to hedge your bets, the other movie that is considered
one of the worst movies of all time, but I personally enjoy it and won't defend the point that I enjoy it, is Magical Mystery Tour, the Beatles movie.
Wow! Did you like pre-plan a course of film snobbery with your selections? How did you know that these were going to be your... Okay, no. All right, go ahead. You were saying...
What's the surprise?
No. I mean, I'm just surprised.
Magical Mystery Tour is considered one of the worst films of all time.
Is it really?
Yeah.
I consider it a bad film. I can't watch it, but I didn't think it was one of the worst of all time.
No. Like the Kiss in the amusement park movie is like all-time bad movie.
You're talking about the Kiss battles, the Halloween demon or whatever it was. Yeah, Kiss versus Phantom of the Park.
I mean, at least the Magical Mystery Tour is the Beatles. You know, it's really hard to get a lot of stink on a band like the Beatles.
That movie was slammed when it came out. And for the Beatles, that's the big thing. And then the movie has been considered over the years. Now, it is a cult favorite, and I'm part of that cult that likes it. But it's considered to be like a terrible film.
We meet every Thursday.
Yeah, exactly.
we wear robes.
You know, we wear our snuggies, like druid robes. And walk out. I am the Eggman. Cuckoo Kichu.
All right.
It was that lesser known cult in Waco.
The Magical Mystery Cult. I think it's a perfect stoner film. It's a movie that I can sit down and just have playing in the background, and I love the psychedelic aspect of it. I love that psychedelic period of the last century. So yeah, for me, it has a lot of personal stuff, and I love the Beatles. So
yeah. Well, that way to go out on a limb there. So you like the Beatles.
Yeah, there we go. Like, Disney classic, like Disney animation, and the Beatles.
I don't know. As a black man, maybe that is a big deal.
Man, you heard about Pac-Man? Shit, you heard about Magical Mystery Tour? Get the fuck out of here.
You ain't bad. You ain't nothing.
Shit, man. Fucking 50 Cent got that new joint out, that new DVD, directed DVD movie. Yo, man, I ain't got nothing on Pinocchio, though. Get the fuck out of here.
All right.
Pass another 40.
Pass another 40.
You go to prep school, they be wearing them turtle shell glasses.
Hey, man, I'm
going
to pour a little alcohol on the street for all the fallen Disney animators.
All right, so let's do this.
I'll tell you what, I wouldn't mind seeing something where 50 Cent gets stuck in the belly of a whale and has to, you know, get his way out. I think that might be a way to go for him.
He's bust a cap in his ass. he starts shooting all around. By the way, that's the white guy. I do the shoot like he's Yosemite Sam.
Come on, Brian. You know, at least the whole gun this way.
He's all shooting everywhere. No. All right, so let's do this. By the way, our poll results, very clear. So far, we've got...
it's coming up. Hotel for Dogs. We're coming up like 7-up here, folks. Don't stop believing. Let's Hotel for Dogs all day long.
Votes are still coming in. It is gaining. Hotel for Dogs with 37.06% of the vote. Precious has 2% of the vote. The Messenger has 0.69% of the vote.
And meanwhile, fucking Hotel for Dogs is second run
home. I mean, in a lot of ways, you know, there's a lot of similarities between all these movies. You can really draw the common threads.
You and your David Crumholtz looking ass up there.
Yeah, what's Jed Hirsch up to these days?
And District 9, 62.84% of the vote. Clearly, the people have spoken, and District 9 is their choice. Let's just hope it's actually the winner, because we only have one way that we settle things on NSFW. And how is that, Justin Robert Young?
Well, we call Robert Chang, and we just ask him to pick one of the movies.
Did you just say Robert Chang?
Robert Chang first. And then if he's not available, we call Roger Chang, who is, of course, the beloved tech punter.
Well, I think Robert is his brother with Down syndrome.
Sure, yeah. Robert, Justin Robert Chang was what I was called all through high school.
All right, I'm going to see if we can get him on the air. I'm calling Roger Chang right now because Roger Chang is the final arbiter of everything on the show. I called him before.
When you call him, it's not going to go ding, 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 ding. Oh, my God. Because that would be fucked up.
That would be terrible. Hey, Roger, are you there, buddy?
Yes, I am.
Oh, my God, it is.
I'm ready for Ford Sync right now.
On the phone, we got Roger Chang. Hey, listen, Roger, I don't know if you know this. We're doing a bit of a contest here. We're trying to pick the best movie of 2009, and I need you to pick between the numbers 1, 2, 3, or 4. And keep in mind, your vote will be final, and then whatever it is will be the winner.
So the do numbers, I get to know which movies are for which nope. number?
I don't see why that's significant. I just need you to pick 1, 2, 3, or 4.
Again, Robert, it is 1, 2, 3, or 4.
He
said 2.
He already picked. Well, what was the number again, Roger?
Number 1,
which means the best movie of 2009 is, in fact, Precious.
Woo! Robert, you're a good man. You know what? I felt bad because I was about to get like, pick a fucking number, Robbie.
I was about to call him Robert.
Or whatever. Robbie.
About to get him, Robbie. Again.
Robbie.
Robert.
Rubber dub.
So, Precious, since it's the best movie of 2009 and NSFW People's Choice, I think that's what we're going to call the award.
A person's choice.
Yeah, the NSFW person's choice.
Here at New Sauce
award
for Whores.
Yeah, so everybody who voted, waste of time.
Yeah, half
of them voted for Hotel for Dogs anyway. That was a waste of time.
Much like the 2000 presidential election.
That's right.
Your vote was a waste
like
of time.
Actual voting. Waste of time there.
I people. Like your co-host, man. He's a lot of fun.
Yeah, he's a cool guy.
He's a real cool
guy. You know,
we got to steal him for our show.
Originally, they asked who I wanted, and I said, I'd like the two of you guys. But they're just like, you know what? We're going to stick you with this guy. He's a plucky, weird. He's a
you know, it really is an old boys network like,
no,
here.
Bro, we got
Twitch.
Money. You don't have to settle for black guys.
We got Ford Sync as a sponsor now.
Get
Come
yourself
on,
a nice white guy who looks like a Jew.
That's right.
Exactly. If you're so stuck on the ethnicity thing, we'll get you a guy who possibly is a Mexican Jew Arab, something like that. Okay. Let's get it real ambiguous up in this bitch.
That's right. By the way,
it's funny because he's right.
If you want to see him live, you got to tune in. For those of you listening to the audio feed, make sure to join us every Tuesday at 10 p.m. Eastern. That's 7 p.m. Pacific for NSFW. Trust me, when you actually see the show, it's totally different. We're working on a video feed on iTunes. Stick around. That's coming up soon. Until then, how can we hear more from you, Justin Robert Young, sir?
All right, folks, if you like magic industry news, it is itricks.com. If you like things that are weird, including the Weird Things podcast, it is weirdthings.com. We're doing all sorts of holiday stuff with Christmas coming up. And by the way, my Twitter is Justin R. Young. And tomorrow, I'm going to do rapid fire on my Twitter all day. I will answer every rapid fire question that is sent to me.
Really?
So just at reply Justin R. Young, and I will do it all day. Everybody add me.
That's right. Rapid fire is not a euphemism for masturbation. Thank you for asking.
Hey, yeah. Justin.
No, because that's not rapid at all. I like to take my time.
Strokes. Hey, Justin.
Yeah.
You get paid for this?
No. Okay, are you kidding? It's the internet. Who gets paid for shit?
I thought there was some money involved in this. You bet. Yeah, you were doing a good job, Justin. You better off doing this than we are.
Justin's
thank you.
He gets paid much in Brian bucks. Suited. I print them off.
Brian bucks?
I print them off on my printer. We hook them up.
And what do you get with your Brian bucks? You can come over here and have his dog pee on you?
That's right.
Well, yeah, there's a certain exchange to it.
His wife actually looked at us and said, don't look the dog in the eye. He will pee on your leg.
Yeah, literally. Like, I have like a prostitute dog where it's just like, you don't look him in the eye, you don't kiss him on the mouth, and he won't pee all over you. That's the rules.
Him $10 afterwards.
That's right. So chat room very clearly wants to know the story behind this photo, the Frodo Baggins story.
And by the way, we need to make nsfwshow.com/Frodo Baggins so people who are listening to this can just go to that website and just only see the picture.
Oh, that's a great idea.
We need to make it really easy to be able to see.
Frodo Baggins.
Yeah, that's
the
right.
That's
the Bilbo Baggins song. Well, you know what? We should play the Bilbo. We should have a caller.
Oh, the Leonard Nimoy song?
Yeah.
Bilbo Baggins.
So real quick, let's talk about spill.com. Where can people find out more about spill.com?
All right, the spill.com. Where they, first off, they can go to spill.com. That's the easiest way.
When did that start?
Golly. We began with the real deal some 12 years ago.
Go to spill.com. The site is under some new innovations, so in about a couple of weeks, probably three, maybe a month. Next year! The site is going on, we're going to have some new innovations on there, so tune in for that. And
it's a Web 2.0 site. You can join, become a member. You can chat with all of us. We're on there constantly.
Let me tell you, you guys get the difference about Web 2.0 and old media. It's like, it's about interactivity. It's about respect for your fans. It's about, and that's one of the things we try to do here on NSFW. That's why we integrate the chat room. We read everything that's coming by. We respond to them.
My friend.
What's that?
If somebody wants to know what's the difference between us and, like, say, like, Ain't It Cool News, respect for our fans. We love our fans. Interact with them all the time.
Black people is what Justin says. That's the difference.
Spill.com brought to you in Negro Vision.
We're actually only two black guys on the whole thing.
Yeah. Well, I don't think we even have any black members.
That's right.
Of course, it's the internet.
We're starting a new site called cornyblack.com.
Where it'll be just like a podcast of us watching a Prayer Home Companion.
It's pretty cool. The site has actually gained a lot of popularity throughout just the past few months. We are going through an innovation. We are starting to have new giveaways and new contests. So we're giving away more DVDs and other prizes. It's too late. We already know who you are. Okay. And Leon is right. The thing that sets us apart from other sites is that we do interact with a lot of people on the site. And we also have, coming up in June, we have our first Spill convention, Spill Festival.
I didn't know if we could actually say that or not. Is that confirmed?
Well, two years ago, we had a Spill party. And we had so many people come from all over the country for it. The last year, this year, actually, in the summer, we had kind of a Spillapalooza where it was like the whole weekend.
Yeah.
So now he's hooking it up to where it's going to be like a whole weekend festival.
Yeah, I just came back from New York, and I think I have the – I think I can safely say, like, look for June 11th. Through that whole weekend for us to have our first Spill convention. And I won't say too much right now because it hasn't been given the exact green light, but we're very close.
But I will say we have booked the following people. No, I'm sorry. Go ahead.
No, I guess it will be fun. And the thing is that even at these conventions, our whole hook is that we will go out, mingle with the crowd, talk to everybody, try to come out and introduce things, and try to make ourselves a big part of the festival by interviewing people on stage and introducing the films that come out and whatever else happens. I mean, it's going to be very, very heavy on interactivity with our audience. So.
And the big thing is the party at, you know, on the next little, or the last night or the next to the last night. We always have a huge party. We get around talking to everybody. And at some point, even though I don't want to, I end up taking a bunch of people to a strip club.
Even though that will not be an official part of our agenda.
No, it is not. Time. You have to knock three times and whisper low and know the password.
That's right. Yeah, the password being, hey, will you please take me to a strip club?
But yeah, spill.com is the name. Go see it.
All right, and by the way, I do my best. I'm not, I don't know if I'm able to keep up with it quite like you guys are, but I try to respond to all the emails. If you want to get in touch with me, I'm at brian@schwood.com. You can follow me at Schwood. That's S-H-W-O-O-D. Schwood. At Schwood.com. And, of course, Scam School, new episodes every Thursday. And I tell you, and if you're listening to this on audio, if you're listening to this on iTunes, you've got to watch it live just once. Before you hit unsubscribe. That's all I'm asking for.
Wow, Brian, way to really sell us to the moon here. Hey,
I'm just saying, give up on us entirely.
Believe me, after we're on, like, they're going to say this. That's probably going to be a big possibility.
Mass exodus, I think
it's
they'll
gonna
call
be,
it.
I'm going to perpetually be
by the way, Brian, your mic's off.
What's that?
Your mic is off. You're
my
talking
mic is off?
On
no, it is not.
Their mic.
That's that. My mic is not off.
Well, no, now it's on. Because you turned it off.
Well, it was always on. I don't know. I don't know what's on. We'll figure out. You know what? We'll just have a robo voice speak my lines in the middle of that. They were like, make sure to tune in to NSFW every Tuesday night.
All right, so let's. Scam School.
Listen, if you guys.
Hey, man, Scam School is really cool.
Yeah, it is.
I got to say, like, you know.
I think it blows.
Oh, come on.
We knew you when you were doing parlor tricks
in a bar.
There's no hotel
for dogs.
You know, escaping from a straitjacket.
You knew when I really was scamming at the bar.
But man, I love watching the scam schools. I think they're great.
Right on. Well, I'm glad you dig it. Well, I tell you what, you guys want to stick around and take some calls in the after show?
Sure. Oh, shit. Yeah. Calls of death.
No, okay. Calls of death.
Hey, Brian, also, real quick, people are screaming and yelling about the Frodo Baggins story, apparently. And I just wanted to point out that Brian was the guest on the Magic Stars podcast on the iTricks site, and we talked about the Frodo Baggins story.
Yeah, we did talk about the Frodo Baggins story. Head on over there.
If you guys
want to
get a little bit more insight, go ahead and download the Magic Stars podcast from iTunes or on iTricks.com.
By the way, chat room is pulling a fast one saying if Schwood cared about his audience, we'd hear the Frodo story. And it's like, I'll not fall for that trap, sir. You know I love you very deeply, and I'll not fall for it. But that's going to be it for this episode of
Correctamundo
NSFW. You know, I love all of you guys very deeply. Stick around. We're going to play around with the after show.
See you next Tuesday.
See you next Tuesday. I just got that.